été pris. Alors, 3, tu les donnes tous ?
Thank you. French, you don't understand Texan. It all works. Patty.
Patty, you know where the restroom is? You're going to give directions to the restroom.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, can we get started? I'm Dr. Alan Karsrud. You better call me Alan. Don't worry about trying to pronounce the last name. It's Karsrud, and it's what we call bastardized Norwegian when somebody showed up at Ellis Island. Thank you, Brandon Mullen. Important information. Patty, tell us where the restrooms are. Okay, that's the important information. Everything after that is irrelevant. First of all, I want to introduce somebody that this meeting would not exist without him, and that's our good colleague, Adam. So, thank you. I'm the honorary conference chair. I had somebody, I was the person he could go on Facebook at 2 in the morning and talk to. So that's how I ended up in this role. Before I introduce our keynote speaker, we have a special remote guest, right? Remote. Anybody know Norris Kruger or the name Norris Kruger? Well, Norris should have been here, but once again, he missed the plane. We have a short video from our beloved Norris. It's about 9 minutes, but you're only going to get about three. Okay, so we'll start with Norris's. There he is.
Piece of paper and a writing implement. Okay? Yes, we'll wait. Okay. Three questions. I want you to answer them as quickly and as concisely as you can. In other words, don't give a Norris answer. Three quick questions. As fast as one sentence as fast as you can. What is your burning question about entrepreneurship? What's that one question that if you were going to die tomorrow, you'd want to answer today? Two, what is the most important question facing the field of entrepreneurship? Yeah. What's the one question that'll move the field forward brilliantly? Get quick. Done. Third question. Easy one. What are you working on? And 3B, why is answer three have little to do with one or two? And no, you can't blame your advisor.
We'll stop right there. So, thank you, Norris. I set that up. I did not know Norris was going to do this, but we always know Norris produces something. It fits perfectly with what we tried to do with the theme of this conference, is to say, where should we be going in the field? A number of us have been writing new books on that topic about where should we be going, and we'll be talking about some of those later. But the real thing is, you know, where should we be going? What should you be doing, et cetera? So those questions, keep them in mind, because hopefully we'll try to get through some of that as we go through. At that point, let me turn it over to our keynote speaker, right? Patricia Cotter is entrepreneur in residence at the MIT Accelerator for Global Leadership, I think is what the title of it is, in that process. I'm terrible at reading stuff. The MIT Global Founder Skill Accelerator. I love that. I wonder what that acronym turns out into.
Delta V.
Yeah, okay. That works. Anyway, Trish is very interesting in this process because, like many of us, she was not trained to be an entrepreneur or trained to be an entrepreneur professor. Many of us in this field come from other disciplines. She comes to this discipline from education. It was a doctorate in education. So different perspective, different models. But we've had some conversations in the last day or so that tells me she's going to be an interesting addition to our kind of look at what should be doing. And I've told her, be as challenging. You don't have to be as nice to people. This is Conference of Challenge Assumptions. So at that point, let me turn it over to our keynote speaker, Trish Cotter. Trish.
Our goal, can you guys hear me?
Yes.
In YouTube, nobody will hear
me. Oh, I'm sorry. Okay. Sorry about that. So what the students do is what we want to do is put on programming for the students that mixes them up, those instantaneous collisions where you get a tech person and a business person, really very important to our ecosystem. So we've provided a place where students can come. It's entrepreneurial. There's lots of coffee. There's ramen noodles, that kind of stuff. And then we do our programming. 50% of our, well, maybe I will stand here if you need it. 50% of our students are curious entrepreneurs. And I don't know whether that's true here, but only 10% are ready to go. So what we have to do is put programming. Then we have a third persona, which is ready to go minus one. Those are people who look at the landscape and say, I don't want to be a founder, but I'd like to be part of a startup. The next persona we have is small and medium enterprises that are going to go back to their countries, and they're going to take innovation ideas back to their countries and not going to be big companies. And our last persona is a corporate entrepreneur. So that has been a big challenge for us because there's not a lot of study so far that we've seen in corporate entrepreneurship. So that's a little bit of the conversation today. So one thing that John Chambers came to our campus and he was talking about Paris. He was talking about France and what a great ecosystem it was, and it was about the same size as Boston. So I'm gonna skip that. So I went and decided, let me go take a look at that because I did not realize that. So Boston and Paris, we are in the same spot in a lot of cases. We were leaders at one time, and we're on our way back. So we've lost a lot of talent and funding, and we're on our way back. So if you look at that, Boston is rated number one out of the startups, but it has nothing to do really with the idea. It has to do with the ecosystem that we're creating. Paris, like Boston, has villages and neighborhoods. And those, we have hubs all over Boston on entrepreneurship, and each one may have a little bit of a different specialty. But the reason why we're a startup and why students are now staying in Boston for more is that ecosystem. We have 60 co-working spaces. We have over 40 universities. So those kind of things are helping our ecosystem. And there's over $6 billion was invested in VC in 2016. Paris, one of the issues has always been funding. And it's coming along, and there's new crowdfunding, and there's laws, and you have a new president who I have seen in TechCrunch and other places really stand up for the startup community. So I think that speaks well for the direction that you're going in. So I also tried to say, okay, side-by-side comparison. What does it really look like? And if you look at this, Paris is bigger. Their GDP is bigger. And the number of startups that you have is bigger. But your pay for your software engineers is much less than ours. The equity that you are giving employees is much less than ours. And the cost of living, which was shocking to me, is less here than it is in Boston. But the piece that's interesting is that Series A round, where we're about the same in the average seed round, but when it comes to investment in a large quantity, Paris lags. So if you look at this, I said, okay, let me look at the startups. And these should be, I hope, familiar to you. I wasn't aware of them, but they should be familiar. And if you look at the amount of investment and the funding value, and by the way, you can have these slides, so don't worry about it. You're 5 times bigger than we are, and we have 3x the advantage on funding. So if there's one thing about Paris that needs to be worked on, it's the funding side, and that probably is no surprise to you, but it was a surprise to me. So what I wanted to do was kind of think about innovation. And if you look on the walls, there's this discipline entrepreneurship process that we use to teach entrepreneurship. I'm going to talk about that a little bit at the end. But innovation for large companies. My company, so I've done two, I was an executive. I started out as an engineer and went through and became an executive. And then I decided I wanted to do a startup. And my boss at the time said, you need to leave Boston, go be successful, and then you can come back in because no one's going to invest in A, you, and B, a woman. So that was the problem. And so I left and I went to a startup in Maryland called Visual Networks, and we made network monitoring equipment. And then I came home to take care of my parents and we started another startup, which is Netezza Analytics, that was purchased by IBM in 2010. So these startup experiences have taught me that it is less about the idea, it's all about team, and it's all about how the team collaborates. If the market is ready and the team can execute, they can always work on that. But a bad team, as the saying goes, with a good idea is still a bad idea because they can't execute on it. But a good team with a bad idea can pivot. So it's really important that the team be everything. So why is it that innovation in large companies doesn't work? And what are we doing about it? So at MIT, innovation is invention times commercialization. So the inventions come from all over campus. And then we, the Martin Trust Center, we take care of helping the students commercialize that. So innovations, we're thinking big in innovations. So these kind of innovations, we want students to try to do big things. When else is a 20-something going to be able to say, I want to put cube satellites, size of sugar, a 5-pound bag of sugar, into space and have someone say, heck yeah, we'll help you. Okay, learning to break down big tasks into incremental and building on that is really, really important. So, innovation can transfer firms. These are four cases that they teach in the business school. And here's my first issue, is the cases, these are good, and Corning Glass, if you haven't heard of that, that's one that you should look up. They have on their website, they have a nice view of innovation over the years. And if they started with the covering for the light bulb with Edison, And then they went through, and by a mistake of keeping the glass in the oven too long and it became cloudy, they became cookware. And then they moved to glass displays. There's really a fabulous timeline for them. IBM, who I lived through and I'll talk about in a minute, they did the mainframe to the PC. But this is what we're teaching in our business school. Connect the dot. These are more recent than some of the other ones. They're teaching oil and old style cases in our classes. We need to somehow connect that to today's environment. Last night we had a discussion on the way back from the event, and it was why I've never really heard entrepreneurs quoting the sources that people write the papers on. And in the tech world, by the time the papers come out, we've moved on. The entrepreneurs need research and ideas and trends now. So we've got to find a way to create an entrepreneurial kind of research, a research that comes out and that can be applied, and that the research that a lot of people are doing in here never makes it into the classroom. So we started a thing called EEF. It's the Entrepreneur Educators Forum. It's online, and the idea was to put it online and have world-renowned people come and speak and put that material online for people to look at and use in their classes when they teach entrepreneurship. We thought it would help with that leap, but I'm going to pick on Eric von Hippel a bit. Brilliant man, okay? Very great presentation. You can go on our website on user-centered design. But he talks about x-rays. He talks about semiconductors. It's like me talking about a phone booth. Our students don't even know what those are. They don't know what a beeper is. There's conversations that professors are having with students and with entrepreneurs that are outdated. And that is the one thing that I really would like to see, if there's a way to close that gap. But IBM to mainframe to PC, big innovation. So technology can help the firms. But this is the club you don't want to be in if you're a firm. You know, most of these companies have either died on their way out, and IBM is struggling. So IBM acquired our company in 2010. They acquired our company, and I was blue rinsed. Okay, and that, so IBM is big blue. So they come in and they take out anything that someone might sue them on. Okay, so they kind of clear the decks on that. Then they blue wash you, wash your product. So our product went from an A to a B. So then when they're done blue washing you, they've taken out a lot of the innovation, the open source aspects of your product, and it's your technical people who were used to using innovative tools are now back on a command line. They incent people differently. So it's really, really important to me, that I have found, and that's what I'm going to talk about in a bit, is that there's an issue here with less with technology and more with people. So stages of innovation. Does it work? That should be the first question. Does it work? Because it's not worth really continuing. Can it be produced? Is there a need? How big's the market? Will it be accepted? Can it effectively be deployed? Sorry. So stages for entrepreneurship. If you look here, this is how an entrepreneur, we are teaching entrepreneurs to go to market. Who is your customer? What can you do for your customer? How will your customer acquire your product? How will your customer pay for your product? Then how do you design it? Similar thing, you've got to define your market, you've got to define who your customer is, and you have to know that customer. So how big is your market? Can it be accepted? If you don't answer those questions, how can you bring anybody along on the ride? So the nature of innovation is it may not work. Most corporations are built to prevent you from doing innovation because failure isn't the way to go. You can't fail in the organization. So they're worried about today's bottom line. They're trying to look at tomorrow, but there's this constant pressure. So there may not be enough market for what you're doing, and they may not accept it. So our company was a data analytics. It was called Netezza, and it was a data analytics database that we brought into companies that were using Oracle and IBM. So they come in, And we load our database. We get it installed in less than 4 hours. It's up and running, and people can be running data on it in 4 hours. What does that do to the population inside the company who's wearing a badge that says Oracle database person? What does it do to the person who has an IBM certification? Now they're lost. So we had to work on this last two, which is the target may not accept it. We had to make them relevant. We had to teach them that they could be strategic. So we had them find any pain point, something that anybody, the business, couldn't run, and they became strategic. And that's how our product took off. We got our evangelistic customers happy. But if we hadn't done that, our product would have died right out of the gate. So the responsibility on innovation, I believe, is the value of the innovation you have to weigh against, will it work? And then what will be the collateral damage if you do it? You have to weigh that, because if you don't weigh that, your employees will, your customers will, everybody will. So you've got to weigh this, the technical and the human dimensions. And at MIT, we spend so much time on the technical, and we don't spend as much time on the human factors. So what can you do? Okay, skills are essential. They're very essential, but they may not be present. So you've got to put a skills gap together. So if you're an entrepreneur, when you're looking at the market, you say, here's my value proposition. These are the things that are really my core. This is the competition, and you figure out the gap of where, and you go and you say to your customers, this is what needs to be done. That same kind of rigor needs to go into innovation in your company. So what skills aren't there? Unless you want full turnover in your company. Because it's the people will leave or they'll dig in. You know. But if you can reference how this is going to change, this is the direction, and tell them that they're part of it, that's a very big difference. And I know that sounds easy, but it's very, very hard. So resistance to change is normal. I don't know if you guys have ever worked in an organization where someone said, this is what's going to happen, and there's no discussion. How do you feel when you're part of that? You don't feel very good about that. So you have to have a leader who knows how to pace the innovation. You can't just keep turning the organization. They churn, they burn out. But if you can pace the innovation, take advantage of what the innovation is, provide the training, provide cross-training, and provide creativity in how you deliver it, that will help you all along. So, but the most, it requires leadership skills. So entrepreneurship, innovation, it all comes from the top. Doesn't mean that the top has to do the work, but it does. The messaging has to be consistent through the organization. So solution to this is experimentation. So how do you experiment in an organization? You do some tiny experiments and try them. It sounds, again, very simple. But if people have tried an experiment, had it an opportunity to see a quick win, or a long win, or something like that, and they're part of that, that's key. But it's got to be done quickly, it's got to be done early on, and you have to keep iterating. In the entrepreneurship discussion for how disciplined entrepreneurship is run, it's the idea is that you go out to your customer and you talk to them. You ask open-ended questions, and then you iterate your product with them. You haven't made it yet. You can do it with wireframes. You can do it with pictures. You can do it with a lot of things. Same thing in an organization. This is what you need to do. So failure. Everybody says entrepreneur is a big, there's a failure. It is part of it, and you've got to be used to it. And in a student organization, and I'm sure it's true here, if you want to strive for a good grade. So when we give students problem sets or Excel spreadsheets, there's an answer. When we give them data analysis examples, they're canned experiments. They're not real. They're cleaned up so that there's a right answer. So our students don't understand that, sometimes it's real, there's ambiguity. And we don't do a good job teaching them that. because A, there's a shortened academic calendar, and B, it takes time for the student to work through that process. So we have to do something a little different. And failure is failure, but doing it the same way over and over again, and I will cite IBM on that. They do acquisition strategy. They do acquisition after acquisition, and they're not alone. And how many of the acquisitions actually survive? How many really have the value, realize the value that it said in the business plan when it started? Very few. But my question is, when is the cost of failure the highest? Anybody have an idea? What's the biggest cost that you can of failure that you can have?
Yeah.
Very close. No action. Newton's first law of motion is a body at rest stays at rest. Okay, so you need to, this is 1982. For those of us that are in the field, has it changed? So you have, people don't know how to test and learn. And we need to put more of that in our curriculum, more challenge people on it, and be able to do that. And our students will go to they don't care about hierarchy. They go to the people that can tell them how to do something or help them do something. And then if you get up there, as I said to someone, our students will read everything, they will watch everything, but when you get in front of them, they want you to help them connect the dots. And that's what we need to do. So that means that the innovation also has to be in teaching. So in order to connect the dots, you've got to know what they're thinking. So the way you structure a class is very different. A lot of our stuff, our classroom experiences, are on tables. We can reconfigure for anything because they're all on wheels. They're wheels or they're lights, not everything. Sloan is, there's still an MBA curriculum. But this is the entrepreneurship area. So that we can structure for whatever kind of classroom we need experience. And that's really important. How things are laid out, how students are expected to work together, those are really very important aspects. But we have to be able to experiment to see what works. So one of the other things that I find is people overcomplicate the explanation to people. And believe me, I come from a very technical, people will tell me the chemical reaction of this product, this element, and this element, and you take it in here. No. Tell me what it does. What is your idea, and how can it be valuable? In this case, it's a company. But how can it be valuable? What are your considerations? So if I sit with GE, who now we're working on a lot of corporate innovation with, we have Microsoft, Google, GE, you know, Google, I'll just, for side, you know, the Google Glass wasn't a hit. Google Robotics isn't a hit. Does anybody know why? No. Well, maybe. Does anybody in this room know why? Because no one's really, no one's pursuing them. We're in hot pursuit right now to go get somebody in Google so that we'll disclose it so that our folks can learn from it. We've got to go and work with these organizations that are relevant today, that are moving quickly, and figure out why Alphabet is now, why did they create it? Seems successful, but why? Those are the kind of things that our students are, questions our students are asking us, but we're not teaching that in classes. So we've got to figure out how to close that gap. But back to the framework, the human resources consideration. Everything we do, if you're going to do an innovation, in order to get people on board, you have to simplify it. You can, it's like an entrepreneur. You get an elevator pitch. You get a short moment to grab someone's attention. And so what do you really want out of there? You don't want funding in an elevator pitch. What you want is them to care. You want them to care about enough about your idea so that they want to learn more. Same thing in companies. If you're going to be an entrepreneur in a company, okay, which is a big piece of business coming forward, it's going to be the future for a lot of companies. They're coming into business schools. They're looking for corporate entrepreneurs. You know, this is, governments are looking for entrepreneurs. They're all trying to solve this problem. But the institution itself is part of the problem. But if I could give you one thing, keep it simple. And then the innovation is, try this out and try it on somebody. It's sort of like when you're doing your entrepreneurship pitch. It's, here's the problem. Here's my customer. Here's the problem. Here's my solution. If you make it more elaborate than that initially, No one's listening to you. So this is the critical condition, okay? And I'm going to use IBM. So IBM is in the core, okay? These are two different operating systems. So you have Netezza, my company, on the innovation side, and you have IBM on the other side. IBM used to have this great process where senior executives would work with Harvard Business School, and they would take really hard problems and take people from all over the world. It was prestigious, and they worked together. So we went to IBM and said, you know what? We'd like to revive that process. We'd like you to put the people in the various business units downstream and put them on equal footing with our folks. Because when you work with a large company and you're doing an innovation, it's you and 12 of them in a room. So it's really, really hard to get anything done. But IBM said, nope, we have this process. And it works so well for them. And so innovation, they're not willing to do it. There are other priorities, yet they keep buying companies. But this innovation group has to be small. You need to go after people who have proven to deliver results, that are risk takers, that are collaborative, can handle failure and recovery. Very important. But you need those linkages into the business, and that's what starts to get cut off in a lot of companies. They don't have that linkage, and you start creating two different companies. So IBM looks at us and says, why are you getting free coffee? Why are you getting incentives? And we're barely getting a raise. So the leaders of the corporation have to balance these two areas. But you have to have the innovation group be seen by the company business. So there's another case study of a company called Naturis in Italy. They make quick cooking rice. Does anybody know that company? So there's a good study on it where the company, Riso Gallo is the name of the rice. I don't know how good it is. It's instant risotto, so I haven't tried it. But what they did was they bought a quick cooking rice company, and then they spun Riso Gallo out, and then Riso Gallo made it into a risotto and made it a huge business. And then it goes back into the core. So I think that you can find companies that are doing this, that are surviving. You know, I think GM is now trying this process, and I think this is the wave of the future. If you can have two operating systems, get them to peacefully coexist. But you have to get rid of the bottlenecks. You have to look at the opportunities. So if you're a small organization over here, you may or may not know what the window of opportunity is in the company. So how do you know when to strike? So Corning. Corning is another good example. They created a separate company, and Corning found out that there are chemicals that people weren't buying the technical service within anymore. So they needed to innovate. So what they did was they spun that problem out to this innovation group, and the innovation group came back with ideas to make it so that ordering supplies, minimum requirements, those kind of things. It helped the manufacturing bottom line because they were building in bigger volumes. It helped the service organization because it was now predictable as to what was going out and the problems. They trained the organization on bigger, how to handle big bulk kind of issues that customers would have, but took away the nuanced technical things of new product development and said, we need to be able to support mature products. That is what your innovation group can do. But again, as I said, it's the human element. So just in case you didn't get the human element, key risks of innovation, talent, talent, talent. How your people respond to it and how they respond to their peers around them is absolutely key in adoption. Training, you have to invest in it. My dissertation was on data analytics education. And the difference between what universities would say, they are producing problem-solving, critical thinking students. At MIT, that's what we do. We don't train them for business. So to expect them to be able to, on day one, be able to perform is unreasonable. But companies have cut a lot of their training programs. So we need an investment in from companies to say, okay, this is what we need to do. We need to help an ecosystem. An entrepreneur without an ecosystem is lost. So we have a thing for our students where we have four pillars. We have head. We can teach them capability. We can give them opportunities to try. We can give them a home that they feel in an ecosystem, but they have to have a heart of an entrepreneur for this whole ecosystem to work. Students will connect with someone who's very close in front of them. If you bring in a lot of star entrepreneurs, they forget what it was like to be a startup entrepreneur. And then if you only bring in entrepreneurs that are success and try to find an entrepreneur who's had a disaster who's willing to share, some of them are very good at it, other ones are not. So you need to be able to bring those people into your classes, you need to be able to bring them into your organization, and you also need to bring people who are doing innovation properly and innovation disasters into a company for the same reason. Technology is really important. The difference in technology, and when IBM took us over, they took out all the forward-thinking tools that we had that made us look 100 times bigger than we were. And they went back to command line on customer service. They went back to, and we would help a customer when they called the IBM. You call, you have to have the warranty number first before they'll even help you. So the change in culture, the change in technology, the change in organization was key. And then incentives. We were incenting teams. IBM incents individuals. And that was a killer for the whole culture of our company. So tools to get you started. So if you're looking at this and you say, okay, how do I get started if I was a company? Or, you know, I want to look at other things. This is the first time I've met a lot of the people in this organization. I didn't even know it existed. So, but now I have resources. I didn't know. And in a lot of cases, entrepreneurs don't know what they don't know. Companies sometimes don't know what they don't know. So we've got to figure out how to get the message out there. We can't stay in an academic bubble and not bring the things to the companies. They don't have time. So we've got to figure out how to be very relevant. And actually, teaching assessment, we were talking about last night, very, very important. If you're an educator, how do you measure whether an entrepreneur is learning? It can't be that they got funded. It can't be that, you know, that they've been in business and they have this many people, although we track that metric at MIT. It can't be. You've got to figure out whether they're actually learning, because our example is that students on probably the third try finally get it. So if we can give them opportunities and programming early in their life and their education, then by the time they swing at the ball the third time, they actually can hit it. Up until then, it's questionable. So, and by the way, they all think they know everything when you start. So if you talk to a student, they will come in and they will talk to us, and they'll say, I need funding. That'll probably be the first thing they ask, and we say, have you spoken to a customer? And the answer will be no. But it's beautiful. It's beautiful. So, you know, we have a student that was working on a pump, solar pump. So they were an 85% more efficient pump. They wanted to go to Eastern India because they wanted to change the life of farmers. They wanted to change it so that they could plant 2 to 3 times a season instead of one. Had they ever been to India? No. Okay, they read everything and they did secondary research, but they'd never been on the ground and talked to people. First thing we do on a plane, they go to India. They go to India and they find out that the wells are 4 inches. Great. Our pump is 5 inches. So it isn't even going to work. So primary market research, absolutely key. Understanding your customer, absolutely key. Whether you're a corporation or you're an entrepreneur, very, very important. But you can also really start working more collaboratively. So I referred to Harvard as our arts and crafts school up the river. But in fairness, we do work quite well with them. And we do work with BU, which is Boston University, because we don't have a law school. So the collaboration in the ecosystem is really, really important, whether you're a university. But we also think that universities could do much more with the corporations in our hub. And that's what we're going after now. We're trying to have connect our students so that they can get in and they can learn. So there is, and I don't know whether it's true in Paris, but in students in the U.S. have a very high debt ratio. Okay, so they have a lot of student debt and they have to clear it. And so that they go to Boston Consulting Group, McKinsey, Goldman Sachs, just because they clear it. But that doesn't mean they're not entrepreneurs. Later on, and Babson told me last night that they do a study that says after graduation, is it 5 years, Candy, after graduation, what percentage?
47%.
And when they graduate?
It's between
10 and 17%. 17%. So a lot of them, my guess, is they're clearing their debt. And then they're turning into entrepreneurs, or they're working for no salary for a period of time, and then they finally get a salary. So it's one of those things. So tools people can do, you can scout out. If you're a university, you can scout out what's in there and find out what's relevant. Okay? Mergers and acquisitions for a company are really, really important, but they've got to have those operating systems, and they've got to find out how to peacefully coexist. Incubators are very, very important, and an incubator isn't an accelerator. An incubator is where it starts. So an accelerator means that you're going to try to accelerate either the learning or accelerate the venture. And corporate venture funds are very hot right now in the U.S., where they're coming in. So GE Ventures, Google Ventures, Microsoft, they're all coming in with venture opportunities for their students. And actions that you can take. If you don't have an innovation ecosystem, our president gave us $2 million to go invest in an innovation orchard. He wants innovation all over MIT. We can't spend $2 million that quickly. Okay, it's not going to be a year. It's probably going to be a few years by the time we get it. But we do dole out $1,000 pretty quickly to our students. And what we find out is the student thinks they need money, but when they really actually start the project, they don't need money. But there's a lot of things that you can do at your university. You can do speaker series, but you've got to know the personas that you come in. As I said, we have five. So we have to put cross-programming together for all of our personas to make sure that everybody's welcome. Because if you find out that you're not an entrepreneur, at least at MIT, I'd rather you found it out there before you took somebody's money. So, discipline entrepreneurship, I think this is really important. I was telling Candy last night that even the font, okay, that's on here, it's fun because our students are looking at problem sets all day or they're looking at Excel spreadsheets all day. And so you've got to catch them. They've got to be interested. And the time to catch them is the beginning of school, where our accelerator, which is a summer accelerator, starts and demos for the students. But the students, we try it. They really do not like to talk to humans. And there is a PDF online that's free called Talking to Humans. Strongly recommend it. It's one that, you know, it's an easy read. It'll take you half an hour to read. And it's just how to ask questions that aren't leading. So many students come into our facility and they've already asked the customer and they've led the witness. So for instance, if they have a technology that says open, I can open it without touching it. They go into a hotel lobby and they say to them, is there something that you could do that if you just wave your hand, something could open or something could happen? Well, yeah, they gave them a whole list of things like opening the elevator, you know, making sure reservations are done. But are those the pain points that a customer really has? No. Those aren't the pain points. Those aren't the ones that are going to get the adoption. So very, very important. So who is your customer? What can you do for your customer? How do you acquire your customers? How do they pay for it? Then how do you build and test? Then how do you scale? So students say to me all the time in the business school, and I'd be shocked if someone in here didn't say, I don't know how to program, so I need a techie. Okay? And that is so not true. You can learn basic programming, learn how to program, create what your vision is, even if it's rudimentary, then go have a talk with a tech person. Then you have credibility. It's not you're going to steal their idea, or if they have an idea, it's not that you're just going to use them and let them for this project and move on. You start a partnership. Very, very important. And I also think the size of the teams are really important. We want a hacker, which is the tech person, a hipster, which is the design person, and a hustler, which is the business development person. Any bigger than three or four people, we find that the students don't know how to manage a team, and they lack focus. But if a student goes into a venture capital person and can say to a venture person, this is my market, this is my beachhead, this is my end user profile, this is a persona, an actual person that would buy my product that I've met with. These are the 10 customers that I've met with and I've iterated what my product will look like. This is what my MVP looks like. If you're an investor, are you more likely to be able to invest in that person, understand what they're doing, and have confidence in that person? We think yes, rather than someone who's just going to go in and whiz you on the technology. And it is changing in Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley used to be, give them an idea or a whisper, and they would invest. Boston's a little bit more where, show me it works, and then I'll invest. But those kind of ecosystems, you have to know what you're working in. So if you can find a way to get your product to market, you can find a way to keep your company relevant, I think that's what the future of entrepreneurship is going to be. So we believe successful entrepreneurship is the skills of a good pirate and the skills of a Navy SEAL. So, and again, it's not the strongest of the species that survives, and you've probably seen this quote, nor the most intelligent, but it is the one that's most responsive to change. So, and that's it. Thank you. Any questions? Yes. I'll come with it.
I love your model. It's very similar to what Stanford talks about.
Yes. We talk a lot.
But there's a thing that keeps popping up, and I guess it bothers me more and more as I get older and work around the world. We're putting an American, fundamentally an American model of how entrepreneurs into a world market that doesn't always think that way. And I'll give my best example. Challenge you where we talk about failure. There are many cultures, many languages, in which the concept of failure is just totally unacceptable. Mm-hmm. So asking people to, well, be willing to fail is like, should I be able to take a gun and shoot myself? Because that's where we're at. I mean, I think we have to be kind of careful when we take these models and shove them other places, even
right.
in Europe that look, you know, alike. And I'll give you Australia as an example. They speak fundamentally the same language. You can't go bankrupt in Australia. You go bankrupt in Australia, you will never own land again. It will take you 20 years to be able to get a bank loan. You're fundamentally screwed.
Right.
And that is in a country that is Anglo-English. I mean, this is, you know, and you say the same population as the entire population in the United States. But over the years, here's this notion of what failure means. It's just simply not acceptable. Mm-hmm. In the process. So I think these models had to be tweaked to make this stuff work.
Oh, absolutely. And we had a woman come in, and they're trying to change, and this is Norway, they're coming in to change the energy industry to become more sustainable. And her organization lacks the skills to do that. So she came in to say, how do I do that? How do I create things? So that's why that list of things has lots of things that can you have to see what your risk is. But it's the leadership that's going to allow that, the incentive, the pay cycle. If you're going to penalize people for failure, they're not going to do it. They're not going to be innovative. But you also go to countries that have no unemployment, a very low unemployment. They're not really interested in entrepreneurship because the economy is coming along. So for the U.S. in particular right now, entrepreneurship is very hot. Okay, it's a way for students is particularly to work for themselves and get investment. And so for them, this works. But I do think that you have to adapt this. This is a very American model. But it's also a streamlined model. And I think you have, even if you have a chance, if you know your customer, what you can do for your customer, You're in much better shape.
One thing I might add.
Go ahead.
One of the things that I keep thinking of, you talk about entrepreneurs as if they're leaders.
Mm-hmm.
We're not teaching them how to be leaders.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not teaching them. When we talk about leadership, we talk about transformational leadership and all this other fun stuff. There's a very unique type of entrepreneurial leadership.
Yep.
And you're just now getting people like Richard Harrison and Maya Rinko and others who are studying this area. But we haven't really figured out how do we teach that leadership process to an entrepreneurial team that may only have three people in it.
Right. So we have, so you are spot on. We had a program where we had a donor who was willing to give money to students to go out and have an entrepreneurial experience at a startup. So we took them out of our Delta V. These students graduated a year before that or 2 years before that out of our accelerator, and they were hiring these students. We found out they didn't know how to hire. They didn't know how to do a job description. All of those things. And had we not done that program, we wouldn't have found that. So now we take it, we fix our model, and try to enhance that education process. But, you know, and I, as I said, our students don't like to talk to humans. Imagine getting up in front of an investor or getting up in front of a company or they want to go to the tech. Okay, so there is a piece of this that we have to keep giving them opportunities to fail inside the university. So we try to provide a safe zone for them. We call it an honest broker approach, which means that we can't have people who aren't interested in the students' best interests working with the students. And so coffee, for those of you who are entrepreneurs, is not just coffee, okay, with a VC. It's an impression. So if you're not ready to make a first impression on a VC, you shouldn't be having coffee. But that's, you know, the kind of skills, it's the school of hard knocks, entrepreneurship. They'll find out, and then they'll find out people leave them. You know, they're very trusting. There's lots of things that an entrepreneur has to learn, and it's less about the idea, it's more about the team.
I have two comments, because you talked very early on, you talked about corporate entrepreneurship.
Yep.
And you said you don't see very much about that.
And you don't see very much about that in the literature. The interesting thing is, a couple of years ago, I did with some of my Swedish colleagues, we actually went through the articles. And the thing is that corporate entrepreneurs, they are called innovators. So once you are an entrepreneur in a big company, you're no longer an entrepreneur, because an entrepreneur is somebody who does something small, who starts something that probably doesn't fly. Whereas if you're a corporate entrepreneur, you're an innovator that does something serious, something successful, and usually you're an engineer.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And this was a very interesting part to find.
So, and to my point, you know, I understand that, because that's the entrepreneurship as well, but it's an engineer. The problem is that in order for innovation to take in a company, it has to apply across the company. And if it's only centered in engineering and is not a collaborative effort to get it done, that's where you run into problems. But I will keep looking for literature.
They change the words.
Yeah, and I will change the words.
Yeah, because you will find corporate innovators, and you will find under innovation, you will find some articles.
Okay, but that's helpful.
It's very interesting. I mean, this is the stuff that we do research on, and evidently we don't communicate our findings very well.
So that's my issue, is that we need more. And talking to people here, I've had more education in the last 2 days of what's out there, yet it's not making it into the academic classes. Our professors are not teaching. There is an element of it, but they're not teaching the innovation, the research that's being done. So we've got to figure out how to bridge that gap. So,
on the other hand, when you have hiring and what you were talking about, go find an entrepreneurship textbook and try to look for anything that deals with HR or human resource
Correct.
Management.
Correct.
That chapter is not there. And if you find it, it will be chapter 19, 2 pages. Pretty much, and that's it.
We know we wrote the
It's not there.
It's true. And that's the whole reason where we're fine, you know, and the emphasis has to be on why they fail is because of the team and the lack of communication.
Thanks, Trish. A very interesting talk. I particularly appreciated your perspective on trying to examine the impact of the education that we do to see whether we're doing it well and various ways of measuring that. And I think that's an important element that we haven't addressed. I'm just going to make one small point, and that is you are sort of, you've been nurtured in a very resource-rich environment that's very rare. We estimate there are only about a dozen universities worldwide that actually make money out of their intellectual property offices. And of course, your university is one of them. So the Boston corridor, Silicon Valley, Israel, there are very few places that where you can launch the kind of firm you're talking about in your model, which is a sort of a world-class, high-growth, venture capital-backed firm. These are extremely rare phenomena.
Correct.
And you're in a place where you might have a better opportunity to push forward. I think when I look at what I would recommend for Paris is, you know, I wouldn't recommend they start a film industry because that's done in California. They've got a monopoly on that. I wouldn't expect them to go into high tech because that's covered in Silicon Valley and a few other places. So I think as we move around, as we scholars and experts in entrepreneurship move from place to place, we need to recognize what are the opportunities in those places and be very hesitant to take the models that work where we are and extrapolate and suggest, well, you know what, because it sounds like you've got a fantastic thing going in MIT. I love the model you put up. Mm-hmm. No question, it fits your environment. But you know, this is Paris. There are different things here. Here, there's fashion. So if I was really interested in launching something new in fashion, then my question is, would I follow exactly your template? And I'm not so sure that it works for fashion. I'm just giving you one small example.
Right, okay. So we have Armoire, who was in our accelerator, is like a Rent the Runway. So you'd never think a Rent the Runway fashion would be coming out of MIT. We're doing mental health. We're doing hard sciences. We're doing marketplaces. I would say marketplaces are the hardest, trying to figure out both sides of the market. But I'll disagree with you, because I think if you know your customer, and you know you've got a market segmentation, and a market segmentation meaning here's the different markets I can put my product in, and even if it's fashion, which element of fashion would it be, here's my beachhead. So I'm going in this beachhead, I'm taking this narrow focus to start. I know what my adjacent markets are, but I'm gonna go after this. I've seen whether there's a, what the market size is. So I know I can make money there. So if I know that, and I know the customers, and I can know what the end user profile is, I think that that can be useful everywhere. Because if you can explain who your customer is, then you know your customer, your employees know who your customers are, those kind of things. I think that this is basic. It doesn't tell everything for sure, but it's a great way to get started. And then you can adapt from there. But I will say we do have a good gig.
No.
We aren't lacking resources. I will acknowledge that.
Good morning. My name is Paul. I'm from the Netherlands. I like the essence of your story, although you focus very much on startups as source of innovation. In the Netherlands, we have seen that 99% of the startups don't exist after 5 years. We also see that subsidizing sectors, like don't go into movies, don't go in high tech, also don't work. Mm-hmm. So at this moment, if I truly believe in innovation, but I also think that we should forget startups and focus more on scale-ups. Probably companies that exist already for 3 years, they know how to hire people, fire people, find a customer. So probably innovation in scale-ups would perhaps be the way forward for Paris and perhaps also for Europe. So move away from the startup and look more at the scale up?
Well, transformation can come in a lot of things. It can come into operational transformation. Michael Hammer wrote an HBS article on this that, you know, they use an insurance company as one of the examples of trying to find out and narrow the focus because the competition was so big. So you've got to figure out what your innovation is and then figure out who your market is and then how you're going to get it and how you're going to right size or right scale your company for it. So when I put innovation on the side, you know, it's innovation coming back into your company and then figuring out how to do that because the core business can't spend time on it. The core business has to deliver today. They're usually right-sized for the business today, and they don't have the time to go do it. So if you don't put another organization together to help think about these things, but that's trusted and that can go back and forth and has the core business as its benefit, because if they're the benefit of just coming up with new ideas, that's not going to work. But you've got to come and find an innovation that will work and leapfrog your company. That means you have to understand your competition, you have to understand the skills in your company, all of those things. So, you know, I think maybe startup, in a startup world, maybe it's innovators, you know, to use that word.
Thank you. Last question.
Galway University in Ireland. Do you find from your startups, and it's kind of relating to that gentleman from the Netherlands, that a lot of them basically get acquired after 3 years. Mm-hmm. So basically they become either serial entrepreneurs or basically they're really in it for a quick escape. And the venture capitalists do need an exit strategy. Because mm-hmm. we're finding in Ireland is that and we have adopted the Stanford BioInnovate model, and we now have TechInnovate on those two programs. We've customized to Ireland, and they're working very well. But I'm finding that a lot of the companies that have become very successful sell out to multinationals.
Yeah.
And they don't engage in a scale-up. So there's an issue for taxpayers' money, public money, gone into these fellowship programs.
Yeah.
But not just that, but also other startup companies that have got a lot of funding. And you know, there's kind of a controversy there. What's your experience?
So, you know, very true. There is a lot of money being spent on these startups. And as I said, on the list of things, there's acquihires, which is a lot of what this is, where people acquire a company just for the skill set that they have. So all that money that went in there is creating the skills that the company benefits for and pays for. But they pay those entrepreneurs. And they don't pay back the ecosystem. But so the whole idea here is for everyone to give back. But I find most students aren't necessarily, and a good entrepreneur really isn't usually, that will last, isn't necessarily in it for the money. There's a driving passion that they need, that they want to bring something, they want to change something. They really want to own this themselves. And in a lot of cases, entrepreneurs end up with very little equity. The VCs or the investors make out with much more money. And so, you know, the entrepreneur itself, you know, I think we have to continue to feed that innovation because otherwise you don't have jobs. You know, you don't have a thriving economy. And I think that they both can help. So if everybody works together, everybody benefits. But if you start being, you know, this is only industry or this is only startups, I think that's when you have a problem. I don't know whether that answers that question or not.
Thank you so much, Trish. So we will have the first roundtable, and after the first roundtable, a little coffee break. So I call now Malin Brongback, Alan Karshrud, Candida Brush, William Gartner, Benson Odding, and also Denis Grégoire.
All right, so while the panelists are getting ready to panel, I guess, We've all been sitting here for already an hour. Some of you may be tired, so if you want to take a break to stand up, get activated, so that we can get the conversation started, please go ahead. Pouvez-vous mettre debout quelques instants? Bitte stehen Sie. On s'active un petit peu, on respire un petit peu. Let's just get our blood moving a little bit. Alors, les panélistes sont prêts. The panelists are ready. Are we ready to engage in some sort of conversation about the future of entrepreneurship? So, here are the way we'd like to do this. The theme of the panel is, in the program, it is about cognition, affect cognition, gender, diversity. So we're really talking about individual level research, and the way we'd like to do this is have perhaps we'll start with short interventions from the panelists, but after that I'd like to engage more in a conversation with the audience. So I would suggest that you start thinking of questions you would ask the panelists. And the panelists, when you get a question, please don't feel like all of you have to comment. It could be that the first question, Candy takes it, and then Benson has something to add up, but then we ask another question. And the other rule that I will have is that in order to really have a conversation, we're going to have shorter comments, meaning that we're not going to start pontificating, someone taking the lead, talking for 2 minutes, and eventually not getting to questions. We want to have a bit more of an interaction with the audience. So I suggest that when you make your intervention, you keep it short, you keep it to the point, and we see how the panelists respond, and then someone else in the audience might respond. And if it doesn't work like this, I'm going to intervene. And if it doesn't work, and if it still doesn't work, then I'm going to intervene in French. And then I'm going to intervene in German if I need to, and I don't speak German. So we're going to try to get this started. All right? So how do you want? Then we could do that as well. So are we going left and right? Your introductory statement, sir.
Well, I think the first thing we need to start, and I've kind of made these comments earlier, I think we need to look at entrepreneurial leadership. How do you teach that? And I think it is teachable, but we haven't really done that, and we haven't researched it. We haven't researched how to teach it or what it includes. There are some people out there doing it. Number two, and it kind of goes with something Trish was talking about, I think we need to be looking at issues about we intentions and teamwork and how you build those entrepreneurial teams. I've been studying entrepreneurial intentions for 30 years. And most of it looks at a single entrepreneur, not how does a group work together. And if we talk about dealing with large corporations, let's remember most businesses are family businesses. So how do you start talking about we intentions within a family business and who's going to succeed? So that kind of sums mine up. And is that brief enough, sir?
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. I'll pass it on to my colleague.
Okay. One of the things that I've been bugged by in a couple of years is that if we did work on growth entrepreneurship not so long ago with Alan, and went through the bloody literature. And it turned out that most of the articles on growth are studying not startups, but established companies, and actually companies that were fairly big. And this was because you could find data from various databases. So what we did was to go out and find the numbers. And here is where I have my problem, is that I think if you want to do research on entrepreneurship, you have to get out there. You have to actually talk to the guys who are entrepreneurs. And then you get issues with methods and everything else, because these qualitative studies is something that some journals don't really quite like, because you can't do your structural equation modeling on qualitative stuff.
Hi, my name is Candy Brush. So I started off studying women entrepreneurs and sort of looking at women, sort of biological sex. Are there more women here, more men here? What are the differences? And so over the years, the notion of women entrepreneurs has evolved, and now we think about the role of gender. And so I think this is something that is becoming very important, not just in entrepreneurship, but in other disciplines as well. And so when we think about sort of the masculinity or femininity, the gendered aspects, how does that play into entrepreneurship? How does that play into opportunity construction? How does that play into the ways that people think about starting businesses, growing businesses, performance of businesses? And then, of course, what is the role of culture and families in that whole sort of context for how entrepreneurship evolves? And so that's what I'm going to leave you with.
It's all about me, yes. Bill Gartner. I'm actually at Babson College now.
As of just this minute.
Like today. Just as soon as we pass the mic, I've decided to be at Babson. Norris has three questions. What do entrepreneurs do? Second, what do entrepreneurs do? What do I do? What do entrepreneurs do? That's it.
Thank you, Bill. Okay, we're in Paris, so I'm going to cite Piketty's work on global inequality and capitalism. And I think what's happening often is entrepreneurship is the answer to global problems that we're all observing. I think that I'm not so sure if that's the case. However, I believe that we have a responsibility to honestly use anything in our capabilities to examine the issues of growing inequality and the implications, the issues of refugees, the issues of opportunity advancement that we're faced with in the world. So I just, you know, quickly point out that Corning, which was mentioned as a success story, now has about half as many employees as it used to. Most of those employees are very low-paid employees. Most of them are robots because Corning produces more glass than ever did robotically. You have factories that are empty where there are no people working in it. So I think as entrepreneurship scholars, we should be looking at these questions, which is who's going to work? What kind of work are they going to do? How we're going to facilitate that transition, and how we're going to maintain societies where only very, very small element of people have these very, very high quality jobs, and most everybody else is in a different world.
Thank you, Benson. So you see that as a panel, we have quite a variety of positions. We start with talking about entrepreneurial leadership. We talk about like going out there on the field, we talk to real entrepreneurs. We're talking about the interactions between the individual and the context, is the essence. We have the three questions from Norris and Benson with a statement on the doing research that's meaningful for society, right? So how do we want to go about it? What are your reactions? What do you want to ask the panel? Anyone wants to start? You're all shy. All right, then.
I'm gonna make one comment. I think that we get, and this don't take offense, Trish. I think we get obsessed with technology. And you come to Paris, and what is Paris? You know what I'm gonna spend my next 12 days doing? Art museums. Anybody who knows me, that's my passion. Collecting art, going to art museums. Artists are entrepreneurs, but we don't study them. Musicians are entrepreneurs. This is a city full of operas and ballets, and yet do we as entrepreneurs, entrepreneur professors, ever study that as an industrial sector? I mean, we look at food. My God, you go to Lyon, you come to Paris, what do? You don't go to McDonald's, and you don't eat healthy. You eat good food with lots of fat, red wine, and you have fun. Now, the point is we don't ever study chefs as entrepreneurs. And yet those are important industrial sectors where I'll take some ways I'm going to argue, yeah, the robots have replaced. It's going to be very hard to find a robot who's going to do a really good job with the latest piece of ingredients that's rare and it's not on somebody's program. So I'm going to argue that we are not looking at where some of the jobs are. They're not sexy, but boy, are they interesting to look at.
Okay, I can take up on that one because as of late November, I'm running a big Interreg program where we're looking at archipelago entrepreneurs. I come from southwest of Finland, where there is an archipelago. And then we also have companies over at Stockholm Archipelago. So we're actually looking at these different companies over there. And we have 30 from southwest of Finland, and we have 30 from Stockholm region. And when we started recruiting these companies, because it's about developing them to the next stage, I sat there and was very worried, because usually when you look into archipelagos, you tend to get into crafts and tourism. Crafts and tourism. And I said, this is going to be just one of these programs again where we're looking at crafts and tourism. We have to think about this differently. There's got to be something else in this archipelago. If there isn't, we have to develop that. Okay, so we went out and started looking, and we found clean tech, we've found construction, we've found energy technology, we've found all sorts of fun stuff, and of course the crafts and tourism. But I'm getting really, really very interested to look at these small companies that are not crafts and tourism, to see what they're doing. And they're doing some amazing stuff.
But in a way, the underlying theme here is that we have to go underground to look at the real entrepreneurs. Was there another comment from the panelists? Or let's try in the audience once again. One of you wants to engage the panel.
Yes. Thank you. I don't know. Is it working? Yep. Okay. I just wanted to, I don't know if it's not so much of a question, but maybe just to get a discussion started around what Benson mentioned about kind of connecting entrepreneurship studies with societal issues. So we see this in the academy in general about how management studies and org studies can contribute to discussions about societal consequences of business and management. And I think there's a lot of opportunity actually for entrepreneurship scholars to really make a big impact in these kinds of discussions, because entrepreneurs, and I think most people understand this, entrepreneurship or the outcomes of entrepreneurship has many consequences for society. So a lot of consequences beyond just creative destruction. Of course, that's a good concept to have, but it's also quite vague at the same time. So really tackling issues about how entrepreneurship has consequences for work, for sustainability, for automation. Remember, a lot of automation, for example, if you follow back, those technologies came from some entrepreneurs. And once it's scaled and diffused, it has a huge impact on the future of work. And I really kind of think that this is a huge opportunity that scholars could pick up on. Not to say that studying the entrepreneurship process or extrapolating away from the outcomes of entrepreneurship is an important study, of course. But we tend to not focus so much on the consequences beyond maybe just an economic or maybe a social implication, like in social entrepreneurship. But I think there's, I guess that's just a comment, and maybe Benson could expand a little bit about his ideas on that.
Yeah, just briefly, we're observing right now one of the largest refugee crises in, certainly since World War II, in 65 years. So I'm studying that, looking at five or six different countries, because what we have is the same a population of refugees going all over the world and entering different environments. And many of these people were entrepreneurs in Syria when they left. And the question is, well, what facilitates that, you know, reintegration, and how can you help that reintegration as best we can, right? What can we do? These are the kinds of questions we can ask. We have opportunities. The data's there. Populations are there. I think there's a willingness on the part of many governments and regions to fund this kind of research. But first of all, we have to be interested in doing it. Second of all, our journals, I'm not sure how successful I'm going to be in publishing the work on, let's say, refugee labor market integration entrepreneurship. But I think it's an important thing. We have a responsibility. So, I would just leave it that most of us are working for either government-funded institutions, or institutions to get a lot of their research support from government funding. I think we have a responsibility to use that money wisely. And often what we wind up doing is writing articles at Arcane that really have very little impact. And Norris's point about what are the three most pressing issues and why aren't you doing it, I think it's very valid. And the answer is usually, well, people get instrumental. They think they can publish things, get something done, move their career. I think we're asking the wrong questions. We should be asking ourselves, I have these resources. I have these tools and capabilities. What can I do to make this world a slightly better place, and how can I facilitate that?
Thank you. Anyone else from the panel wants to comment on this? Yeah. Research, impact, social?
Yeah, actually, I want to go in kind of a different way, which is that if you're not from North America, I already realize that you talk about and think about entrepreneurship in a completely different way, and it was brought up earlier. And I think this cultural issue is huge, and it's simply not articulated. So Leo and I are doing a thing called Translating Entrepreneurship, where we're going to be publishing definitions to basically articulate that every culture and every language has a different conceptual reality about it. You talk about it significantly different. And this kind of hegemony of the North American way, I think, is, I'll just say it this way, it's evil. It's wrong because it kind of denigrates the nature of kind of world values and where they are. So if we talk about value... What? Yeah, so we've got a kind of a cultural context that certainly we've got to begin to take account for in a larger way that's not happening. So I think the North American export of a particular idea of what entrepreneurship is and how it plays out, what value creation and appropriation is in North America, it's just simply inappropriate. It's inappropriate. And I think the rest of the world's got to begin to articulate who and what you're about in a much stronger way. The American journal system simply doesn't allow that in many ways. The Academy of Management, because I've been trying to push this for a couple of years, doesn't allow it. It's got a strong North American bias that I think has really hindered its growth internationally. So I think we've got to articulate a lot of these different values. And I think that's part of your responsibility, is to kind of have a stronger forum to counteract the fact that the most of us who are sitting in this panel are North Americans.
But Bill, keep the microphone a second. Bill, keep the microphone a second. Could you, like, you're talking about the North American way. In 20 seconds, that's the, like, you're talking about value appropriation.
Well, for example, this originally started with a conversation with Frederica Welter, where we were talking about the nature of entrepreneurship, and I realized Frederica had to make a huge mental gymnastic effort to talk about entrepreneurship to me, as in Germany, there are five kinds of entrepreneurs. There's different legal classifications for how entrepreneurial phenomenon happen and how it's organized in Germany. And I realized, my God, what an unbelievable capability she has to be able to talk to me in my language about the nature of entrepreneurship when I'm clueless about how it happens in Germany, which is a huge culture and doing all kinds of innovative things. So we've got all this stuff going on, and I realize it gets masked in the nature of talking about this in English, as we here are in France, and we're not speaking in French.
Well, that kind of fits this. One of the things that I think we need to be looking at, and we've studied this now in languages that have strong future tense, entrepreneurship is very different from languages that have weak future tenses. Languages that have gender operations function very different entrepreneurial than languages that have weak gender identification in language. We've just begun to study this. And yet it has a huge impact on the number of women who enter the job market, and it impacts a lot about how some countries don't have strong entrepreneurial activities. And it's really often around the language and how language is used. And yet here we are talking English in Paris. This is a little odd. But thank you because I only speak Texas, so you have to understand that.
I was going to pick up on something that you said over there, and so the thing that struck me, and Bill kind of touched on this a little bit, is when you design studies and we think about our research, is a lot of times our default is to go to measures that are already acceptably used. And so we may be missing aspects of understanding entrepreneurship because we go with these standardized dependent variables and these standardized ways and standardized metrics. And so we need to think more broadly about, when you talk about impact, what is the measure of that impact? And how do we go about actually capturing these measures in a broader sense? And so that's something that I think we need to work on.
One other thing, and it's I think critical to this operation, it's not just language and impact, but it's also by the time we get through the process of researching data
and publishing, and I had the privilege of being an associate editor for George at JSBM. You know, what is it, 3 years between the time a paper gets started and it finally shows up in press? The impact's going to be terrible, and that's, you know, how do we get around this time debate that's built within academia that makes it very, very hard for us to be by the time we do something that's relevant on immigrants, Syrian immigrants in Paris, we're going to be dealing with an entirely different set of problems. So that's, I have that kind of issue. Our system is not geared, Bill, to...
I have an interesting observation that I've made, because what we see with our top journals is that we have 2, 3, sometimes 4 rounds of R&Rs. Yeah. If you go over to the science part, what they do, I mean, you do chemistry, physics, or whatever. You send it in. If you get it back, you know, say, okay, revise it a little bit, it goes into press the next time. So they have one round, or they have a reject, which means that that stuff is moving out. I mean, but what we are doing is that we as reviewers, we start to fundamentally write the article that somebody else actually wrote. And the question is that should you add all the reviewers on as co-authors? Because, I mean, okay, they get improved, yes, but I don't believe that you should have 3, 4, or 5 rounds. Somebody has to say, no, this is not good. Go back and do some work and resubmit.
More interaction.
I want to go back to the audience.
Yeah, I just want to say one last thing, and that is I'm very concerned that entrepreneurship is the sort of the answer to all the world's problems. We are beneficiaries of that. So, you know, there's high unemployment, entrepreneurship will solve it. There's growth, global inequity, entrepreneurship will solve it. Poverty in India, entrepreneurship will solve it. Well, no one word can solve the world's problems, and we're oversimplifying sometimes when we attempt to do that. I think what we really need to do is be more systematic in what are the questions we're trying to solve, and you know, and try and find systemic solutions that don't just help this wave or this group, but in fact make radical changes that stand the test of time.
All right, I've been told we have a little bit more time, so please, a question from the audience, Sybil.
Okay, I have more of a comment. I'm Sybil from Israel. I wanted to comment on 2 things, and they are connected. First, concerning entrepreneurship education, I think one of our problems is that we assume that our students are a homogeneous group, and they are very, very, very different, and I don't think we can address them in the same way. And I give just a very short 2-sentence example. We did some research on the impact of the junior achievement program in schools on kids, and we found that when kids come from a low socioeconomic status, it's terrible. It's counterproductive, where they get out of the program and they're really against entrepreneurship. Whereas the kids who come from high socioeconomic backgrounds, for them it's great. They really learn a lot, and they're coming out with more intention, desirability, and so on. And I think the same idea concerns what Benson was starting to say. We are assuming for immigrants, refugees, and so on, that entrepreneurship is something good. But maybe it would be much better for these people to be employed and not to be self-employed. So we're having this assumption we are putting on all these populations, and I think we have to rethink these assumptions.
Your findings are very similar to what Carlos Alvarez Olmos found in Chile, where he has studied every student in every university in the country, and he finds the same socioeconomic variable popping up.
Yeah, I want to make a different point too, but just to go back on that, that's great if the jobs exist. You know, so one challenge is how do you get the jobs to have to put all those people in? Mm-hmm. But I want to build on a lot of the conversation quickly and turn it back to all of you, is about the organization. So completely agree, Bill, about where the United States has been lately as far as entrepreneurship. And when I look at the discipline entrepreneurship, to me it's a commercialization model. You know, and if we're talking about starting a business, we're talking about starting an organization. when I look at the business world of today, I think, really, is this the best we can do? And what can we really learn about innovation in the ways that we organize our businesses as far as how we work inside the business and how businesses work together? You've got a mass of different, you know, interests up there. I'd just be interested in your thoughts on building an actual business, not just taking a product to market.
Thank you.
Well, I live with an entrepreneur. My husband is an artist, and let me tell you, trying to market his stuff, working with other artists to try to get products out, I mean, it's an issue. And when I look at the list, he says, well, you're an entrepreneur, professor. What is the answer? And I go through the list. We have really no answer for a solo entrepreneur who's an artist who wants to expand their business. You pray you become Picasso. I mean, that's about all you can tell them. And, you know, that's you know, we haven't been studying a lot about how to build a business per se. We may talk about innovation. Well, but innovation is also art, and we haven't been dealing with it from that standpoint. It's just, I live with this daily, guys. So if you've got a solution or you need a painting of your dog, let me know. We do that.
Okay. So Patty and I suffer from the same affliction. We sort of have sociological background. So I also employ the same definition, which is, for me, entrepreneurship is the creation of new organizations. And I employ in my classroom, it's all about teamwork and team building. So I have students working in simulations. They reflect on how they work together as a team. I have students working with real entrepreneurs solving problems. They reflect on how they work together as a team. So I look at it as, I look at the course as more one of self-knowledge about how people work in groups, because I fully agree. I don't care whether someone's an artist. You know, even if you're a single artist, you have to have someone to help with the canvases and the marketing, right? So basically what we are looking at is organizations are looking at communication, facilitating how people interact with each other. And unfortunately, our educational system is autonomous. People sit in a class, they answer their exams, they're doing it one-on-one. We're doing very little teamwork and team-building activities in our education. I think it's one thing entrepreneurship can do very easily, which is really reify, really celebrate and develop those team-building skills. And I know some people on this panel are working and putting yourself on, you know, understanding and researching those team skills. I don't think this works.
Oh, they can have it.
Okay, I'll pretend it works.
Here, take this one.
So I think for me, and it comes back earlier to this issue of failure. So, you know, my aphorism is, learn to fail or fail to learn. And if you look at learning in general, it's always about failure. But usually in classroom settings, there are answers. And so if you fail, it's because you didn't get the right answer. But failure in entrepreneurship is different because there aren't answers that are obvious. Value creation happens in all kinds of different ways. So this failure thing is a huge issue because there just is, and this is an issue about what was commented on earlier about Holland. I think there's just huge amounts of churn in the nature of the whole phenomenon. We start at the beginning. To me, I like to use kind of a human metaphor of, if you want babies, you have to have lots of attempts at making babies, right? Usually, it's not like 100%, right? When you spend that effort. And then
it's fun to try.
Yeah, and that's what entrepreneurship is. It's a lot of fun, but most of the time, it doesn't work, okay? And when you go through the whole process, you know, my sense, it's very much like American baseball, sorry to use an American analogy, because it's actually more successful than soccer. Do you know the likelihood of actually kicking a goal into soccer, in professional soccer, is about 1 out of 10. In baseball, to get a hit, it's about 1 out of 3. That's what entrepreneurship is. The likelihood that you're going to make it is about 1 out of 3. So most of the time, you're failing, period. And with businesses, what we know about Fortune 500 companies, the big ones, they last 50 years. Most people are likely to last longer than the companies are going to be in. Okay? That's the phenomenon of organizational reality. To tell students, you will be longer than anything that you ever start. And most of what you start is not going to work. And most of where you go to work is not going to work. So, you know, get on with your life. Yeah, and fail a lot.
Yeah. Comment?
I'm just going to pop in one thing, and that is that it goes back to how we think about how we teach entrepreneurs. This theme has already come up a couple of times. And I think sometimes we get so focused on the content that we forget to think about the pedagogies and how we are actually encouraging people to learn. And so I think there's really a lot of opportunities for innovating in pedagogy, not just what, because you go to any book, any online site, everything, it's all about write a business plan, do a business model, value chain, et cetera, et cetera. Well, how do you teach these things? Or how do you, I don't even know if the word teach is appropriate, how do you help students learn or entrepreneurs learn these things in ways that are productive? And so that's the real question, is how do we help them, engage them, help them to create new organizations and learn in a in a way that is not just traditional teaching.
But I'd like to add on to that. When we teach in business schools, I mean, I happen to sit as a dean right now for a faculty of social science and economics. The examples that we have are usually out of large organizations. But we go into any data, whether it's United States or whether it's Finland or whether it's anywhere else, 97% of our companies are small. So the likelihood that anybody who goes to a business school is actually going to end up working for a small company is very big. Therefore, actually, I think we should make entrepreneurship courses mandatory. I mean, anybody who goes into a business school should at least take one or two courses in entrepreneurship just to figure out what it's all about. Because
we required that 26 years ago.
I mean, Trish was talking about learning to fail while studying, and this is kind of getting to know the reality out there in case you didn't know.
Bill, you wanted to comment, and then I have a question from the audience.
Yeah, and it's about the nature of failure, and I want to turn it slightly to say that one of the aspects of learning, and this is also about being an academic, is when you start out, what you do is really bad. Okay, I'm actually an artist, and one of the problems I have with doing art is that a lot my art's really crappy. Okay, but in order to get good, you have to do a lot of crappy work in order to get better, right? We kind of know that when we do our academic writing, it takes years to figure out how to do it. With entrepreneurs, the same way. So you just bluntly use this word. This is what Lean Startup is about, creating a lot of crap that kind of goes out into the world, that somehow works. Just as we do journal writing, right? We write a lot of crap, and then some of it's good and it kind of makes it. So we're not used to doing that because everything has to be really perfect, right? And we're not in that business. An entrepreneurship isn't in the business of perfection. It's doing crappy things. That's what learning's about.
So I'm Julia from Hamburg. I'm doing my PhD on vocational integration of refugee with a focus to entrepreneurship. And so what you were just saying, I guess, this refugee entrepreneurship is one idea to avoid a lot of crap. Because, for example, what you were saying, Manson, is like if you have an artist, you will need someone to do the business plan. And this is what we noticed in a special program in Hamburg where they took the target group, the refugees, into the core team and just working together, local entrepreneurs and refugee entrepreneurs, just to avoid this crap stuff. Just don't produce ideas. Just what people are saying or what they were learned in the classroom that, well, this is our ideas without knowing the real issues, the real perspectives. And so I just think this is a big chance for entrepreneurship just to go real close to reality.
But the critical idea is that most of what we do is not going to be very good. That's just life. And so, you know, if you have a training program, I mean, this is a problem, too, with government selection programs with entrepreneurs. It just doesn't work because most of what kind of needs to happen is just a lot of stuff. And the market or the world will figure things out, but we don't know. Entrepreneurship is frankly non-predictive. So, you know, just do a bunch of stuff. That's also what we do when we write. Do a bunch of stuff. If you're having fun, cool things will happen. You need to persist over time.
Let me recommend if you're an academic, try starting a company before you start teaching.
So, you know, I think one of the most untapped elements of entrepreneurship is the fact that it really allows an individual to open up their selves to a really existential question. What am I doing here? What do I want to do with my life? So I really think entrepreneurship should be a required course for every student. For every student, there's philosophical elements. There's... Because, you know, maybe you decide, you know what, I sit in my entrepreneurship course and discover that what I want to do is you know, do miniature paintings. Go for it, right? The refugees have got to go through a tremendous transition, a cultural change. They've got to kind of, they're in an opportunity window to rethink their lives. And we can facilitate that, however, and they're obviously going to make mistakes and errors until they find out what it is that they want to do. But we need to facilitate that. We need to do that with students. We need to do that with individuals, and I think we should change the word entrepreneurship to be something, you know, these courses that we teach should really be something about, you know, life challenges, and then go with that.
Is a comment from a lady in the audience?
Well, not really a comment, but a question. So I'm also from North America, but Vincent, I agree with you that there is a perspective, a North American perspective that's really apparent in the literature that I think doesn't even account for the diversity within America on perspectives of entrepreneurship, why people are motivated to do it, why women in particular persistent in pursuing entrepreneurship and business development and business creation as a means of a career. And my question to you, to the panel, is, you know, how can we have the research and the literature reflect this diversity of thought, diversity of approach? I think as an African American, I am completely disconnected from the literature, even though there's a legacy of entrepreneurship in our community that is against the prototype of a wealth creation model versus a wealth distribution model that's communal in nature and that's more that looks more like the rest of the world. So could you speak a little bit to, you know, how and when? Because I don't want this to be the conversation we're having 20 years from now.
A quick one on that. We need to ban linear regression because the phenomenon is heterogeneous. So it's analysis of variance problems and looking at variation across phenomenon. So the linear regression is all about one best way, and it's gotten us into too much trouble. Almost all of the modeling is linear regression in some form. We've got to get rid of it, period.
Yep. We have a paper on that today.
I mean, we want to do something else.
I think we ought to start doing in this process is don't be afraid to submit papers that really talk about this gender difference or talk about racial differences. And you have to talk about why that's important, because a lot of reviewers are going to say, oh, well, that's irrelevant. That's just a control variable. It's linear. Well, it's not. We've learned a long time ago there are multiple paths to being an entrepreneur, and it really is not one path in that process.
So,
and in fact, I'm going to put two plugs in. One, Patty has a book with our beloved Candy on women entrepreneurs and the future look. So please look at that. It's coming out from Edward Edgar this year. Yeah. Secondly, we have a book coming out with Edward Edgar this year on future approaches to entrepreneurship and research in terms of cognitions, intentions, and motivations. So there's two new books. They should be out by August or so. We hope so. Anyway, so look for those. If you got more questions, that's some answers to that.
So I'm just going to – I think you ask incredibly essential questions about what it means and how do communities operate. And I can only answer that in my own research. You know, I cut my teeth working in the ghettos of Kingston, Jamaica, looking at where people were creating survival businesses out of nothing, out of the dirt. And I had more respect for those people than any – zillionaire entrepreneur that can walk in to this room. And I learned more at the bottom working with those hundreds of people that I spent a year working with than I'd ever learned by interviewing, you know, Gates or Zuckerberg or anyone. But I really think that there's opportunity now. This week I leave Saturday for a week in Ghana. I'm on the board of AFAM, Africa Academy of Management, and we're helping people work with developing their research ideas in Africa. And I only use that example because it's an environment that we've overlooked, that we haven't studied, that's very different, just like the communities you're mentioning that have been overlooked and haven't been studied in the literature. And by actually immersing yourself in those communities, we can begin learning, maybe we have to develop new methods, or maybe we have to develop new techniques, but what we need to do is facilitate a dialogue so the people that are working on solutions in their communities get sort of global recognition. Okay, I was recently in Rio examining the same sorts of things. So, I mean, the trick, I think, is to, irrespective of what's in the literature, to spend your energy and time studying those communities and learning what it works. If you want to use the word entrepreneurship, use it. If you don't want to use it, don't use it. But try and identify what works and share that, because there's a very good probability that works in community Y, in low-income neighborhood Z, is going to have relevance for another community on the other side of the world, and we, as scholars, need to facilitate that dialogue.
Madeline, I give you 10 seconds, and then we need to wrap up.
Ooh. Yes, well, the other thing, which I think, if you're going to Ghana, or if we're doing these studies in different kinds areas, we cannot possibly ask the questions the same way, because, again, for instance, entrepreneurial intentions are probably going to play out totally differently in various areas of the world. And what we find as relevant when we're looking from our Western perspective may be totally irrelevant if I go into Africa or if I go into another Eastern European country, well, whatever.
One of the recurring theme in the discussion was that, you know, if you're an entrepreneur, you got to try also different things, see what works, but also have fun doing it. So did you have fun? Was it a fun battle? The audience, you had fun as well? So we're going to take a quick break. Before we do, I would encourage you to continue the conversation, and a round of applause for our panelists. Thank you very much.
one then. Anan,
1 minute.
Midi éditeur, c'est en R03. You put your presentation?
Which one?
For
the editors, that's it? No, Salomon Model. Yes.
The leader.
Yeah. That's it. Great. Which one? Yeah. Okay. Great.
I don't see what they did. Right?
No.
It's okay. You can take your piece.
Dans toute la rêve est décalée 15 minutes.
Oui, c'est ça. Mais ils ont une heure. Regarde. Ils ont
ça va.
Une heure, quoi. Je vais rester dans les trucs. Et t'as les trucs 1, 2, 3 minutes aussi. Hein. Merci.
So there are extra posters right here.
Bill, go ahead for to take some coffee, some juice.
Yeah, where's room 5?
5? Tu lui montres 5?
Right next here.
Yeah.
What do you want to do?
Get rid of this. It's the wrong one. It's the other one.
Okay. What do you want? I can do it. No, okay. What? GSBM with the editors, that's it?
I want number 2. See, there's only a copy.
Oh, okay.
Just get rid of this.
Oh, okay. This is not the good one.
Right, I do it.
Okay. The good one is number 2, that's it?
I believe that's correct.
Okay. Yeah, I have it. I got it.
And this is okay. Yep, that's it.
Up.
Where are you? I don't know.
It's okay.
Okay.
This is yours?
Yep.
Okay. Great. Thank you, George.
Yep.
Go take your coffee, something like that.
We find my name.
Go ahead.
We're back in here, right?
Yeah, yeah. I don't know in which room you are.
3.
3?
Yeah.
It's here.
That's okay. Right.
You have the chairman here?
Me and Louis.
Dana, yeah. That's it, yeah.
Yeah.
Stay here. Okay.
I will.
Okay, for presentation. C'est 0,3 ici.
Oui, merci. Merci beaucoup.
Il y a la première à passer ou pas?
Non, la deuxième. Mais comme ça, c'est fait, ouais, on ne perd pas le temps.
Thank you.
Faites-moi ta présentation.